Sir, taking into consideration the both sides, what I would like to bring forward in this discussion is that let us, as an industry, what we would want is a policy, sustainable policy, a long-term policy, which is not changing as frequently as it is been doing. And second thing is that looking at a DISCOM, what we can, because see, the DISCOM that has been institutionalized in our country for the last several years, their job has been to generate electricity and give. There, as Sachin sir already told very correctly, that there has been some social responsibility of the DISCOM which has to be taken care. There's some policy of the central government to subsidize the manufacturer. But on the other hand, also we should be looking at industry, and they should not be taxed to give benefit only to the consumer for social reasons. As such, the total structure of the DISCOM should be thought about, that whether or not in today's world, today's situation, this kind of thing should happen. And on another hand, I would like to put one point that rather than thinking the individual power plant as a competitor to some state-owned thermal power plant, why can't it be considered as a collaborator, so that the power which is generated extra can be sold to some place where it is needed, and the prices can be brought down. And as a country as a whole, there has been a talk about one nation, one grid. Country as a whole, why can't the power in the whole country go down wherever the generation is more? Let the power be sold to somewhere where there is a deficit of generation, and the rationalization of the prices should be done, which would help both the domestic consumer as well as the industrial consumer. Thank you.
I think this is the most burning issue, and we have touched upon in the beginning of our panel discussion. Yeah, although it is the most important, but one thing I would like to add in this session, that we have seen the renewable energy in Maharashtra last two and a half decades. And I being into this field last two decades, I would just going way back to 1995 till 2015, Maharashtra being very much aggressive state in India, in our country, and MEDA as well as all the stakeholders, MSEDCL, MSETCL, during that time it was MSEB. So everybody was promoting renewable energy. And that is how we have grown up till this stage now. Now this is the time which is, I feel it is the consolidation stage, wherein all the stakeholders, including all other side of the table and all the government dignitaries. Of course, in morning session, all big panelists were there, including our Honorable Madam DG, and as well as now Sachin sir is there. So, sir, basically everybody, I mean, exactly a month back on 4th of Feb, majority of the solar people were on hunger strike across Maharashtra because of grid support charges. And we were also part of that. Although there were two segments, especially rooftop is driven by IPP as well as local EPCs. And the people, those who are only working in Maharashtra, I mean, they are really in bad shape now. Whereas IPP or the developers, those who are working across the country, at least somehow they are managing their show and business plans. But the people, those who are really working in Maharashtra and surviving only on this business in Maharashtra, they are totally in a very, very bad shape. I mean, last 2-3 months, everybody is tensed and in stress. Sir, it is genuine request from and humble request from all of us that please take note of this, and whatever you could do best. Earlier also you were promoting renewable energy, wind as well as solar. So please try to do something for us, something for the industry, and something for the clean energy in Maharashtra state.
Adding to Rahul, I think as Sachin sir said, that there is a cross subsidy. So I think direct benefit transfer, which is DBT, which has been properly followed in the gas and utilities. I think the same thing can be, if replicated into the energy sector or a DISCOM, I think that would give major, that would rationalize those charges. It will better reflect everything. I think this kind of changes, innovations, will help to reduce these kind of charges and eventually bring down the energy charges for the industries as well as the other sectors. Secondly, I think when we are talking about, we are saying it's a 400 megawatt of rooftops been done in Maharashtra. It looks as a big number, but if you see 15% of PLF, we are standing just at a 60 megawatt. Against the energy requirement of 15,000 megawatt of Maharashtra, we are not even 1%. So it's very difficult to understand why this suddenly so many charges have been. Right, sir. Thank you. So why these charges are missed? How much is revenue loss really? It's happening. It's really definitely MSEDCL people can throw more light on it. How this has been done. And that's my.
Yeah, so I'm having a different view altogether. I'm not going to get into the grid support charges altogether. Now, if you look at the energy consumption of India, we are at 3.7% of the world's total energy consumption. We are the third largest consumer of energy. World is going at a pace of 2.2%, whereas we are moving at a pace of close to 4% in terms of energy consumption. Our per capita consumption, it is very low. We are at 1181 per person per year, whereas the world average itself is close to 2784. And we are at a list of 77th in terms of per capita consumption in total countries which are close to 200 numbers. So we are at a very, very low juncture, which does not suit our developed country tag right now. I will never call now India as a developing country. We are a developed country. So our energy consumption is going to increase in future. It is going to increase by leaps and bounds. Now coming to fossil fuel, earlier the power mainly comes from the coal and oil, which is close to 59%. This is worldwide numbers I am sharing you. And it is going to come down to close to 35% by 2050. And the share of renewables, it is going to inch closer to 50%. So whether the government is going to support, it is not going to support, but yes, renewable energy would be the mainstay of energy in future. So as a player in this sector, we don't have to think whether the government is going to support us, it is not going to support us, because at the end of the day, we have the fossil fuels which are very limited in quantity, which is going to exhaust probably 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the line. Now coming to, I'm just giving you some numbers. I was just going through the report of National Electricity Plan, where what that stated is by 2027, we don't need any thermal power plant to come up in India. So this is the extract of Government of India. Now coming to increase in the revenue for the DISCOM. Now 1% reduction in AT&C losses will generate 4,000 crores of revenue for the DISCOM. This is at Pan India basis. I'm showing you this numbers. I'm giving you this numbers. MSEDCL, they are the biggest distributor of electricity in India. In Asia, they are at second number after SSEC China, which is the state nodal agency in China, who take care of the distribution. So MSEDCL has to be progressive. Right now, they are standing at 18% AT&C losses. If they are able to reduce their AT&C losses by 1%, typically they should be able to save 500 crores of not the revenue, but I should say of the bottom line, of the profit. Some states like Himachal Pradesh, their AT&C losses are 0.74%. Delhi in 2010, they stood at 52% AT&C losses. Right now, with Tata, Reliance, they are coming into picture. Right now, their AT&C losses are less than 8%. So this is how they are able to generate more revenue. Yeah. Now coming to, again, I'm taking the P&L account of MSEDCL. I'm having a copy of it. The assets what MSEDCL is managing, it is 1,16,000 crores of assets MSEDCL is having under their belt right now. If you look at their P&L 2018, they had done their sales numbers were 65,000 crores. In 2019, 31st March 2019, their numbers are 85,000 crores. They were able to increase their revenue by 31%. If I talk about the expenses, the revenue has increased by 31%. The expenses has increased by 21% only. So just look at the numbers. Their profit has gone up by 125%, MSEDCL. So 31st March 2019, they were having a profit of 1,096 crores in their books. I cannot vouch for their P&L, whether it is correct, whether there is some provisions that has been taken, not taken, but I am just reading their books of account, which is there in the public domain. So as a solar power or as a RE power stakeholder, as a Godrej, I am not worried whether the grid support charges are going to come or not going to come. It is something that in future you have to go for a renewable. There is no second thought to it. So this is my take. Means whether you put the charges, probably the battery is going to take over. Now we need to just think from the auto industry point of view. All the auto manufacturers, they were hell-bent of IC engines. Now suddenly we are seeing that electric vehicle are going to take over. So what these players are doing? They are getting geared up for the next up technology, that is electric vehicles. Similarly, as a MSEDCL, we know what are the constraints MSEDCL is having. So again, they should think from how we can integrate renewable into with fossil. Because renewable is the one who is going to rule the future.
Yeah. In our discussion, there are many exciting investors that would increase to the megawatt capacity of the state. What biggest challenge, which I could presume, is then how DISCOM would do about the grid? What DISCOM would do about the grid integration? And the how it will manage the demand supply gap. How could it be done if the investors are investing in such a huge amount? Rahul, can you throw some light on that?
So far, we are discussing on the key challenge, which is the regulatory challenge. And of course, as you rightly said, Nandita, unless we have the clear-cut map before investing into any of the project, any of the investor or any of the developer can't take a blind risk. So these kind of charges may be suddenly during operation of the project, any one stage, if suppose something is happening, then it is ultimately the complete IRR is collapsing. So altogether, it is very debatable topic, and I mean, all the stakeholders have already written their says to MERC, and hopefully something better will be declared very soon. But other than regulatory roof as a rooftop, we have many other challenges. I mean, regulatory is one perspective, but there are various other technical challenges, and that I think being the panel, we should discuss. So I think let's start with that. So if you see, Mr. Suyendu, the technical challenges which we are facing in rooftop projects.
I think the biggest challenge I think everyone will acknowledge here is rupees per watt concept. I think this is defeating the entire purpose of solar as an industry. Because as a technology, like when we talk of solar technology when it started, I think it started in a very novel way. But I think with a lot of dilution in terms of quality, the technology that is going through, the kind of material in terms of the modules, the inverter, the electrical BOS that is going, the rupees per watt has been so much generalized everywhere that the basic essence of the rooftop or any kind of ground mounted project which is going to generate electricity, which is an asset for you for the next 25 years, that is defeated, because somewhere the project is performing very well, somewhere it is not performing. So I think this is the core issue. Of course, regulatory issues are going to be it's a very critical factor which we need to solve together, discuss and come out with a common conclusion, because unless we have that clarity as a developer, as an EPC, no one is comforted in the mind that how do I invest my time, my money into the sector, because so many livelihood are actually on this particular sector. Of course, like everyone has that stake. Sachin, thank you. I think I was not aware of the profitability of the DISCOM. I think I need to do that. But of course, having said that,
today it is Sachin versus Sachin.
So having said that, I think once we DISCOM, I think I'll say one way, like if we can really bring out some kind of regulation in terms of capturing the qualitative parameters of the EPC companies or the vendors that are into the value chain, so that good projects will come, you will have good visibility how they are going to perform, and of course at the same time you have to also maintain your I think the regulatory framework, I think that has to be maintained, having said that is a direct manner. So I think this will help for everyone to be going forward in a proper supportive way. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree, Suvendu, that rooftop solar is not an easy solar solution for the consumers, because rooftop also requires operation. And unfortunately, rooftop solar, whether domestic or whether for commercial and industrial clients, only good commercial clients can manage their solar plants in a better way, because they have dedicated operations team. But most of the domestic or most of the small sector where you don't have dedicated teams, managing or getting the maximum juice out of your system is actually lacking. And we are seeing losses to the amount of more than 10 or even 15% losses coming in the generation, because either the panels are not cleaned properly or the inverter is down, people are not aware, they are not connected. Half the time, by the time the operation person comes to know the inverter is down, you would have already lost 2 to 3 hours of generation. So these are the challenges which are taken, because we are a cost sensitive country and everybody is thinking solar as an asset, and they are thinking, rather than let any service provider make money, why don't I put my equity and own the system and then gain out of it, not realizing that as a service model, the service provider is giving you something which he is going to operate and maximize on the generation, as well as it will give you guaranteed returns on your tariff. So I also feel that maybe in times to come we will have a large OPEX model running, where good IPPs can manage large plants, distributed plants of rooftop as well as ground mount in a much efficient way, so that whatever amount or whatever investment has gone into the equipment, that equipment power should be generated. Otherwise, as a country, we'll be losing almost 10 to 15% of power because of inefficiencies of operations.
One more challenge that I could presume for rooftop business would be, I guess, safeguard duty. The basic custom duty around 20% that would come any time in the near future. I think the big IPPs which bid for the tenders, like SECI, NTPC, they take care of in that pricing. But how, I don't know how the rooftop business would cater these things. So you have anything? How rooftop business will go with these custom duties?
As long as custom duty is applicable to everyone in the industry, and whether it is the developer or the EPC customer or end consumer, if they are able to budget it, it should not be a problem. But only thing is, the duties or taxation or regulation should not be a surprise to anyone. Let the industry be given a time of 6 months, 1 year to adjust to that particular thing. That this is the firm date when we are going to put in the duty. This is the duty which is going to come, and let be a level playing field given to all. Okay, so this is my thought process on the duty part. Now coming to rooftop challenges, I'm having a one request to MEDA, since they are the nodal agency and they are sitting here. The biggest risk for, not for the rooftop, but for the sector itself, what I'm seeing is the quality issues. We are always going in for this reverse auction, and then who is going to quote the lowest? Now, as a professional, and this is applicable to all the players who are, or all the stakeholders who are there into the private sector. They will stick in a company for 1 year, 2 years. They wanted to take that order at whatever price it may come. 1 year, 2 years down the line, they are going to switch. With all the NPS that are going to build in the sector, with whatever, how they had constructed the plant. So now it is the prime responsibility of MEDA to have a proper check on the financials of all the OEMs. It is not about the domestic or imported, but it is for everyone. How you are going to ensure the quality of the modules, and IEC certificates are not the guarantee of a good module manufacturing. You can get IEC certificate. I don't want to elaborate it further, but how you are going to ensure that the modules, the inverter players, they are here to stay for a long term. If there are some issues which are going to build in the modules, let's say 5 years down the line, who is going to take care of all those things? There are hot spots, snail trails, everything is coming in the ground right now. Whether you go to Badla Park, you go to Charanka, whether you go to the rooftop plants which has been put up by the developers themselves. So this is a big issue which is coming up, and probably the retrofitting of the modules is going to be a big business model of future. And I don't want that model to grow. So it is MEDA responsibility how they are going to ensure the technical as well as the financial strength of the players in this particular sector.